In this video, we will discuss the fabrication of thin film silicon solar cells on lab scale. The production process of the modules will be discussed in the next video. To discuss production process, we will look at typical structure of a thin film amorphous silicon solar cell. We will then look at processes involved in fabrication such a solar cell on lab scale. In the next video, we will learn about how these processes differ from the module production processes on an industrial scale. We will look at a typical amorphous silicon solar cell as produced in our research group at the TU Delft. Such a solar cell is deposited in a superstrate PIN configuration, so with a transparent substrate, which is the first layer that incident light encounters. A glass substrate is used with a thickness of 0.7 to 1.5 millimeters. In our group, often substrates are used that already have a TCO coating on top of the glass. This is a fluorine-doped tin oxide coating of about 0.5 to 0.9 micrometers. The substrate is cleaned in an ultrasonic bath before a very thin TCO layer is deposited onto the substrate to protect the fluorine-doped tin oxide from the subsequent plasma processes. When significant densities of atomic hydrogen are created in a plasma, the TCO can be blackened due to the interaction with the atomic hydrogen. The protective TCO layer is a zinc oxide layer of about 10 nanometers thick that is grown using a sputtering deposition tool. A thin P-doped layer is deposited next of about 10 nanometers. The doped layers are generally a silicon carbide or a silicon oxide deposited using PECVD. The intrinsic amorphous silicon layer is then deposited with a thickness of about 300 nanometers, followed by an N-doped layer with a thickness of about 20 nanometers. Finally, the back contact is deposited. The back contact can consist of an aluminium, silver or chromium, or a combination of these layers, and usually has a thickness between 0.5 and 1 micron. The back contact is deposited using an evaporation deposition tool. We will now take a look at these processes in the lab. Let's go to the Demus lab at the Delft University of Technology. We will show how thin film silicon solar cells are made on lab scale. Before deposition, the samples have to be cleaned in a so-called ultrasonic cleaning bath. The potential dirt and dust particles are removed. Since a solar cell device is only several hundreds of nanometers up to a few microns thick, a dust particle on the substrate will generate a shunt between the front and back contact in the final solar cell. Here we use a substrate that is coming from the Japanese Asahi Glass Company and already has a TCO coating on it. The TCO coating is a fluorine-doped tin oxide and is responsible for the hazy color. In this movie, we deposit a thin zinc oxide layer on top of the Asahi substrate to protect the tin oxide from the next processing step. The substrate is mounted on a sample holder and put into a load lock. A load lock is a chamber in which the substrate is brought under low pressure before it's moved into the processing chamber. This avoids the processing chamber to be contaminated with various unwelcome atoms and molecules present in ambient air. During sputtering, the zinc oxide target is bombarded using an ionized noble gas like argon. The generated aluminium zinc oxide species are sputtered into the chamber and deposited onto the substrate. Here you see the sputtering plasma. After the sputtering processing step, we have a glass plate with a tin oxide with on top a very thin zinc oxide layer. Next, the samples are mounted into a different substrate holder. This substrate holder is used during the plasma enhanced chemical vapor deposition step, PECVD step, to deposit the various thin silicon films. Again, we use a load lock. The load lock allows access to the various chambers. Every chamber is dedicated to deposit a type of silicon layer. P-type silicon carbide, intrinsic amorphous or nanocrystalline silicon, and N-doped amorphous silicon or N-doped nanocrystalline silicon. Typical pressure Precursor gases in the deposition plasma are silane diluted with hydrogen. An RF bias between the electroplates generates a plasma. The silane is dissociated and the silicon contained in radicals and ions are deposited on the substrate. Adding dibrane or phosphine to the plasma makes the films P-type or N-type. Increasing the hydrogen content makes the films nanocrystalline instead of amorphous. The samples are moved from chamber to chamber through the load lock. After the various silicon deposition steps, the sample with a thin film silicon PIN junction on top looks like this. Next, the samples are covered by a mask. The mask determines the areas on the sample where the metal contacts are deposited. The samples are mounted into a processing chamber. Silver is used as source material and particles of silver are put in a boat. The silver is evaporated using an electron beam. The silver vapor deposits on the samples and form the back metal contacts. After taking the solar cell out of the E-beam evaporation setup, we can see the final silicon solar cell on lab scale. Every metal contact represents a solar cell. After back contact deposition, there is a final annealing step where the substrates are placed in an oven for an hour at about 150 degrees Celsius to improve the ohmic contact between the individual layers. So this is how solar cells are made on a lab scale. On a small glass substrate, 30 separate tiny solar cells are defined by a metal contact of about 16 square millimeters or 8 cells of about 1 square centimeter. If you want to process multi-junction thin film silicon solar cells and an additional PIN structure based on, for example, hydrogenated amorphous silicon germanium alloys and hydrogenated nanocrystalline silicon alloys will be deposited after finishing the N layer of the amorphous silicon cell. On a module level, the manufacturing of thin films is quite different in some respects, as the cells need to be interconnected. We will discuss the module manufacturing process in the next video.